The Jet Propper's family eventually was conceived initially by Hunting Percival jet-powered aircraft, of course, the trainer, as I've mentioned, and really essentially to replace the Percival piston Provost aircraft. And the jet version made its first flight in June 1954, with the prototype making its first flight from Luton Airport in June of that particular year. This aircraft, a T3, actually November 673, was built by that company, also out of the Luton factory, and was collected ready for service in August 1961, I mean, by the wrong decade here. Over on the right hand side, okay, so a variety of maneuvers, nothing too dramatic. Now of course there are still restrictions pertinent to the flying of vintage aircraft, but nonetheless this is a really capable and stable machine, an ideal aircraft to be training in. We were talking about pulling various minus and positive elements of G earlier on, and when you're upside down, if you're not pushing too hard, then it's just the weight of your body pushing all that blood into your brain, and you sometimes get a thing called red out. But relatively low G manoeuvres during this particular performance. So going out on what we call the 45, the display is all set up on what we call the A axis and the B axis. A is left to right, just a straight line, and you can see those marker boards out there. That's all along the A axis, and that's the positioning, the lateral separation, and then the B axis is a line going straight out in front of us, and you'll see various aircraft coming in on that as well. Now, I mentioned Ollie, a young, talented chap. He joined the Air Force in 2007. He spent 3 years at Church Fenton with the Yorkshire UAS. So many of the modern pilots do. Many of them come through the Air Cadets as well, and then spend time whilst at university training up. And of course, very, very useful background, and it prepares them even better for then when they eventually enter the full training network. We don't have a tutor with us today, but all three services start on that, as Ollie did, and he was streamed fast jet after that flying the Tucano at Linton on Ouse, before then completing his advanced flying training and tactical weapons on the Hawk T1. Lovely knife edge pass now, and as I say, he'll be looking down, and all the pilots can see well. It's a good cockpit, the JP, a bit sit up and deck, as I would say, and with a bit of a panel in your face, so to speak, but really a very, very safe indeed. He's recently been serving on 31 Squadron and served in a variety of different places on operations as well. And he bought a share in this aircraft and worked hard to get it up to himself, up to his play standards. And I know, big smile on his face today. First orders for JP T3s was made, 40 of them, in June 1957. And at that stage were recently upgraded with a powerful biplane jet engine. You can hear now the ejector seats, a redesign of the airframe, and a shortened and strengthened fuselage, of course. But this aircraft, a later model, having been delivered in the early 60s, issued initially to No. 3 Flying Training School at RAF Leeming. For the aircraft number 13 until 1963, then went into storage for many years before being declared eventually non-effective. Originally destined for firefighting practice and moved to Winterborne Gunner. Coming part of the NBC Defence Centre, which actually celebrates its 100th anniversary next weekend. Like so many of these old aircraft, they whether propeller or jets, they go through a variety of different hands, and many of them languishing either in structural airframes or just in storage for many years. that got her first post-restoration work in the summer of 88. Then in the early 90s was repainted into a new colour scheme. Before then moving to North Weald under a new ownership of the Seagull Formation Group. Currently operated under the Classic Jet Preservation Group, and they're now getting a little more adventurous and also busy with this aircraft. The last genuine JT-T3 flying anywhere, the lowest hours with only 1700 hours on board. Lovely departure from Ollie there, nothing pilots like better than doing off in the climbing, rolling into the wild blue yonder of the sky, being very kind to us now. Really outstanding stuff.
Which is more fun to fly, an aircraft like that which is very stable, or an aircraft where you've got to, you know, have your wits about it to keep it in the skies?
Well, it depends what level of competency you're at, yeah. To be honest. I mean, the great thing about the JP series was that they were an ideal platform, really. They're relatively benign. I trained on the JP3 myself.
Right.
And, you know, when I subsequently then went back and flew some of the vintage trainers, even a chipmunk is quite a handful if you're not used to that, particularly off hard tarmac as opposed to grass. In fact, most tailwheel aircraft can be a problem. And then, of course, with the torque effect of propeller-driven aircraft as well, you get a swing on takeoff, which they get with a jet. So there are all sorts of nuances with each level of aircraft. I mean, they often say, many pilots say, well, the bigger and better they get, so the more technically advanced, the easier they are to fly.
Right.
Because, of course, you've got so many then additional flight management systems.
Yeah.
You know, something like JP3, it's actually, you know, ergonomically was not desperately well designed, because we didn't know quite as much about that in the 50s and 60s. And, of course, that has all improved as well. The management of how we fly and operate machinery in general has been, tremendous advancements in a sort of technical and academic study of all that sort of work. And it's all to basically blend in with the limitations of the human being. And that, at the end of the day, is the sort of...